The Lord is my light and my salvation. So why should I be afraid? The Lord is my fortress, protecting me from danger. So why should I tremble? The one thing I ask of the Lord, the thing I seek most, is to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, delighting in the Lord's perfections and meditating in His temple. The grace of God has reached for me and pulled me from the raging sea, and I am safe on the solid ground. The Lord is my salvation. His strength will help me scale this walls. I'll see the dawn of the rising sun. The Lord is my salvation.
It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praises to your name, O Most High, to declare your steadfast love in the morning and your faithfulness by night, to the music of the flute and the harp, to the melody of the lyre. For you, O Lord, have made me glad by your work, and the works of your hands I sing for joy. The grace of God has reached for me and pulled me from the raging sea, and I am safe on this solid ground. The Lord is my salvation. Fear when darkness falls, His strength will help me scale this wall. I see the dawn of the rising sun. The Lord is my salvation. And who is like the Lord our God, strong to save, faithful in love? My death is paid and the victory won. The Lord is my salvation. For you make me glad by your deeds, Lord. I sing for joy at what your hands have done. Oh, how great are your works, Lord. How profound your thoughts. Senseless people do not know. Fools, they do not understand. That though the wicked spring up like grass, and all evildoers flourish, they will be destroyed forever. But you, O Lord, are forever exalted. My hope is hidden in the Lord. He flouts each promise of His word. When winter fades, I know spring will come. The Lord is my salvation. In times of waiting, times of need, when I know lost, when I am weak, I know His grace will renew these days. The Lord is my salvation.
Truly, my soul finds rest in God. My salvation comes from Him. Truly, He is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will never be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. So trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to Him. Oh, for God is our refuge. Amen, church. Shall we all stand? Let's sing our hope.
My hope is hidden in the Lord. He flouts each promise of His word. When winter fades, I know spring will come. The Lord is my salvation.
Yes, He is.
In times of waiting, times of need, when I know lost, when I am weak, I know His grace will renew.
Who is like you, O Lord? You are mighty to save, and you're so faithful in love. Jesus, we thank you that it's because of you all our debts are paid. It's because of you, Jesus, of what you have done on the cross. Victory is won. In Jesus' name, we can declare this over all circumstances in our lives, over all the situations. That's why this morning we can stand here and lift up our voices, declare victory, sing of who you are. Oh Lord, fill our hearts, fill our voices with this melody, with this this victory with this song. Oh Lord, all victory belongs to you. We praise you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come, church. Let's sing of our Abba Father. No weapon will prosper in Jesus' name. No darkness will prevail in Jesus' name. Let's sing this together. The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. My God. My God will never fail. Let's sing this one more time. The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper in Jesus' name. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. We sing. My God will never fail. And I'm gonna see a victory. And I'm gonna see a victory.
You take what the enemy meant for evil.
turn it for good. You turn it for good. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. And I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Yes, Lord, the battle belongs to you.
Come, church, let us raise a hallelujah to our Lord who is above all. Let's go.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies.
I raise
a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, and the King is alive.
I raise
a hallelujah with everything inside of me. I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. Oh, I raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. I raise a hallelujah. I feel you lost your hold on me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. And louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, and the King is alive.
Come, church, today, wherever you are, whatever situation that you are in, let us raise a hallelujah to our Lord, the Lord who is above all, the Lord who is worthy, the Lord who leads us in the midst of the storm. Let's sing.
Sing a little louder.
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 Oh, sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
gonna sing in the middle of the storm. And louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, and the King, one more time, you sing, I'm gonna sing, and I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. And louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
I'm gonna sing,
and I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
Yes, Father God, we want to thank you that we can sing hallelujah to you. No matter what we have gone through this past week, whether is it an easy time, a difficult time, whatever battles we are fighting, Lord, we surrender it to you. And we thank you that the battle is not just ours, it is yours. And we thank you. Thank you for this time each week of blessed Sabbath rest. That we do not just want to rest physically, we also want to rest emotionally. And most importantly, we want to rest spiritually. So Lord, as we enter into this time of rest, of worship with you, we pray that you will encounter us and we will encounter you. And we will experience this restedness that we can have in you. Knowing that we are on the winning team. The victory is not just yours, but also ours to share. We thank you for this wonderful privilege of being called your child, of being able to fight alongside you and experiencing victory. So Lord, I thank you. May this bring a smile to your face. And as we prepare our hearts to worship you, Lord, I pray in recognition that all we have received from your hand. Thank you for all your blessing. May you receive it. May you multiply it. May you give wisdom to the leadership of the church to use the money for the extension of your kingdom. And may you continue to bless the cheerful giver so that we can always continue to be faithful in our giving and raising our hallelujah to you. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Let us prepare our hearts now to worship the Lord with our offerings and our tithes. If you are giving by digital means, you can scan the QR code and key in the amount. This is your act of worship. This is your way of worshiping the Lord. This is not just a bank transaction. So please be prayerful about it and worship the Lord. If you are giving cash, we want to remind you that do not drop cash into our bank account because it will incur charges for us as well as check. You know, don't drop it off. Mail it to us. If you are giving cash, you can wait for worship to resume on site and bring your cash and drop it off into the offering bank. God bless you, the cheerful giver.
Still, my soul, be still. Do not forsake the truth you learned in the beginning. Wait upon the Lord, and hope will rise as stars. stars appear when day is dimming. God, you are my God, and I will trust in you and not be shaken. Lord of peace, bring you a steadfast spirit within me to rest in you alone. I rest in you alone. In you.
Sabbath keeping is an important foundation of the rhythm of worship for Israel. While we do not observe Sabbath as a requirement of the law today, it provides an important bedrock of a contemplative lifestyle. When we observe the Sabbath rest, we slow down to examine our souls. We acknowledge the lordship of God and the sovereignty over our lives. Friends, in this COVID-19 season, we find ourselves very busy. Things are constantly changing, lines between work and rest blurs. Kids are always around us. All the more, having a rhythm of Sabbath becomes a crucial as they become pit stops to realign our priorities and goals to the Lord's. Particularly today is Father's Day. To the fathers who often work tirelessly to provide for the family, how are we doing as fathers? How are we leading and caring for the souls of our families? John Ellis shares this poem. Dear Heavenly Father, can you forgive me for hurting my children? I came from a poor background, so I thought that a big house would make them feel important. I didn't realize that all it takes was my love. I thought money would bring them happiness, but all it did was to make them think that things are more important than people. I thought spanking them would make them tough so they could defend themselves, but all it did was stop me from seeking wisdom so that I could discipline and teach them better. I thought that leaving them alone would make them independent. All it did was force my son to become the father of the other son. I thought that by smoothing over all of the family problems, I was keeping peace. All I was teaching them was to run rather than lead. I thought that by pretending to be a perfect family in public, that I was bringing them respectability. All I was teaching them was to live a lie and keep a secret. I thought that all I had to do as a father was make money, stay at home, and supply all their material needs. But all it taught them was that there was even more to being a father. Now, the problem is they will have to guess what being a father really is. Dear God, I hope you can read this prayer. My tears have smudged a lot of words. So friends, how are we doing as fathers today? Let us turn to Him who gives compassion and wisdom as a father. As Psalms 103 says, just as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he himself knows our frame. He is mindful that we are but dust. And may you have a blessed Father's Day.
Superhero. My daddy.
My daddy.
Your daddy? How is your daddy a superhero?
He fixes everything in the home.
He fixes everything in the home.
My father does devotion with me even when I don't want to.
My daddy because he does a lot of work for me and helps earn money.
I love my dad because he's hardworking and he studied really hard to become a teacher.
I love my daddy because he plays with me and brings me out for food.
What kind of games do you play?
PS4.
I love my daddy because we always go on a food adventure together. He's kind, gentle, and slow to anger.
My dad is a superhero because he's a bus driver. He drives people all around Singapore.
My daddy is a superhero because he's a firefighter.
My daddy is a superhero and he helps me with my schoolwork.
But even superhero daddy and mommy have their own superhero daddy.
My grandpa is a superhero because he brings my brother and I out for good food and sometimes buys presents too.
My grandpa loves me by giving me chocolate.
He loves us by helping cook.
Akong Andrew is a superhero because he teaches people how to dance cha-cha-cha.
Grandpa loves me by asking questions about my life.
My grandpa plant papaya in Johor. But not this way. Bye-bye.
I love my Akong because he's a really good tennis coach and he taught me how to play tennis.
My grandfather asked me to help him get some things from the kitchen because he can't walk very well now. But when I don't get it right or make mistakes, he still forgives me and appreciates me.
Oh, the greatest superhero of them all is our Heavenly Father.
He is a daddy to mommy and a daddy to Akong and Ama.
Even to us are Akongs.
Does so much that he sent his son so that we can live with him forever. Now we all get to call him our good, good father.
I'm so happy that I have God as my father in heaven.
Happy Father's Day!
Happy Father's Day!
Happy Father's Day. It's not easy being a father. I know that, right? So I can understand, I can empathize, and we oftentimes feel unappreciated. Sometimes we feel very bad. We don't get affirmation. And but nonetheless, we want to still try our best to be like our Heavenly Father. So let us, at this time, pray for our fathers, and then at the end of the service, give your fathers a hug. If your fathers are not with you, you can call them or text them and send them something appreciative, okay? Yeah, let's pray together. Father God, we want to thank you. We thank you for the privilege of being your children, deeply loved by you, your compassion on us, words cannot articulate. But at the same time, Lord, we want to say thank you. Thank you for modeling to us fathers and fathers to be, and even spiritual fathers, what it means to love our children and to love our wife. So Lord, I pray for all the fathers in our midst, in QBC, and not just in QBC, but in Singapore, and not just in Singapore, but around the whole world. I pray for all the fathers that we will be able to reflect you as our Heavenly Father well. Because, Lord, the image of a father in a child's mind is so important. So, Lord, I pray for all the fathers out there that you forgive us for all the shortcomings. Forgive us of all our wrongs. And we pray that we will be forgiven. We will receive your forgiveness, and we thank you that you are the God of second chance. You always give us opportunity to do better. So Lord, with each Father's Day, we pray that we will do better. I pray also for the wife and also for the children, that they will learn also to appreciate the Father and also love the Father. So we thank you for Father's Day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so after the service, you cannot bring your father out for a meal, because we still are under heightened alert. What you can do is give your dad a hug. I know it may be awkward for some of the dads, but do something special, okay? Hug your dad, say something special to your dad, and make your dad feel special. We want to welcome everybody home. Welcome and thank you for joining QBC's online service. Although we are not able to meet on-site yet, we thank God that we can still worship online. If you are new with us, we ask that you kindly scan the QR code and fill in the form so that we can keep in touch with you. We will continue to suspend all on-site services and programs until further notice. We encourage you to join our online service every Sunday. Sunday service goes live at 10:30 a.m., service starts at 11 a.m. with pre-worship at 10:50. We encourage you to keep your spiritual rhythm of Sabbath rest or Sunday worship service together with us as a church. If you like to view the service again, service will not be made public after the online streaming, but if you like to watch the service again or invite your friend to do so, it will be made public on Monday, 10 a.m. onwards. All right? July CPR, we are having CPR in July. July CPR will be incorporated with Journey Onward. Okay? And it will happen during DG time. It will happen the week beginning 4th of July. Please take a special effort to join your DG to come and pray together as a church. All right? July also will be having Journey Onward. Journey Onward happens twice a year in QBC, in January and also in July, to remind us of our vision and our mission. And in July, we will be having a Journey Onward. So the first week is on Spiritus Vitae. Spiritus Vitae, we will have the CPR, which is on the week of 4th to 10th of July, the fervently praying church community. And then second week, we will be having Imago Christi, which is our family faith journey. All right, and that will happen on the week of 11 to 17th. And on the week of 19 to 24th, we'll be having live on Mission in a Digital World, which is Missio Day. Okay, so these sessions will be conducted during your regular DG hour, Gen Paul and Y-Wave meeting, in place of the usual materials that you use. If you are not in any group and you like to join a group, please contact Pastor Rebecca or and we will be happy to allocate you a group. In August, starting from August 14th, we'll be having a class on the art of parenting. As parents, we hope that our children are healthy spiritually. QBC hopes to equip our parents to be able to care for their spiritual growth. Art of parenting, aiming your child's heart toward God, will be conducted from 14th August to 9th of October. Registration starts from 27th July at $20 per person. If you have any inquiries, please contact Pastor Rebecca. Today's preacher is Pastor Isaac. I will pray for us, and then he will bring God's word to us. Let us pray together. Father God, I want to thank you for this time where we can open your word and hear your spirit speak to us. I pray for us that we will not just be hearers of your word, but more importantly, doers of your word. I pray that you anoint your servant, fill him with your spirit, use him as an instrument to bring your grace to us as we remember the rhythms of grace. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
What a privilege it is for us, right, to be able to worship together. Now, I really wish that we were all here live, but we are not. Yet, nonetheless, you know, to be able to connect over the internet, to worship online, is still a privilege. And so we continue in our series, titled Rhythms of Grace, in June. I actually wanted to title it Spiritual Disciplines, you know, but I was vetoed by the other pastors. But understand, these spiritual disciplines or rhythms are means of grace, which means that there are ways that we get to experience the grace of God. And so I think rhythms of grace is good because it denotes a lifestyle of drawing close to God. And so in this month, we are looking at the grace of the word, the grace of worship, and today the grace of Sabbath, next week the grace of prayer. You know, with real transformation, I think firstly we must understand it's always an inside-out Holy Spirit-guided journey. It's never outside-in, it's never enforced by habits, but rather it's inner transformation. And it's not a journey we do alone, but to be part of an authentic community that pursues transformation together. And that is what we hope our DGs are, that we come together to share lives based on the Word of God, but really to learn to listen to God, to discern His will, and to pursue transformation together. And finally, it's based on a reflective lifestyle, a lifestyle of contemplation. And that is where we are talking about all our spiritual disciplines. And today, we're dealing with rhythms of grace, the grace of Sabbath. Let's commit this time to the Lord. Father, as we open your word, I pray that you speak to us. May we see Christ lifted up and you glorified. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You know, back when the telegraph was still the fastest mode of communication, a young man applied to be a Morse code operator. So he came to this office on the address listed on advertisement. It was a big office with people walking here and there, very noisy, and there was a telegraph machine at the reception area. There was a sign that says, take a seat and you'll be called into the office. So he took a seat and, you know, there were other applicants there before him and they started talking. And then suddenly he stood up and walked into the room. The others were shocked. It's like, who called him in? A few minutes later, he emerged with the manager who said, thanks for your interest in the job, but it's just been filled by this young man. And so the others, they protested. They said, hey, you know, he jumped queue. We were here the whole day, but we didn't get a chance to be interviewed. And then the manager said, he's all this while we're sitting here, the telegraph machine has been typing out a Morse code message that said, if you understand this message, come right in and the job is yours. Now, you didn't come in and he did. You know, every time I listen to this story, I chuckle because it reminds me of the world we live in. A world that is noisy, distracting, lots of activities. And then how then do we discern the still small voice of God? How then do we know that we're walking in the will of God? You know, of all the good things that we can do, how do we know we're doing the right things? That we live a life that is meaningfully occupied, but not busy. And so these are some questions I want us to think about as we look at Psalm 92. In Psalm 92, when we talk about the grace of Sabbath, we'll see three motifs. The motif of covenant, creation, and paradise. Covenant, creation, and paradise. So as we go into the Psalter, into Psalms 92, I think there are two important things to understand. Firstly, the Psalter or the Book of Psalms is really made up of five books. Along the way, somebody edited them and put them into five books. The first two, there's high concentration of the Psalms of David. Their hope was in the Davidic dynasty, the sons of David. And then the third book, you know, we call it the dark book, you know, because there are a lot of psalms of lament, especially Psalm 88, 89, which is the last two psalms of the third book. You know, it's totally bleak. And that was the time where they were taken into captivity in Babylon. The Davidic dynasty was no more. There was no more king in Israel. So where was their hope? And so in the fourth book, beginning with Psalm 90, we are brought back to the Exodus, to the God who led them out of Egypt, to remind the Israelites that their hope was never in the sons of David, but to the God of David. And more so, the God of David, the particular seed of David that was anointed, the anointed one, meaning the Messiah, the Mashiach, the Messiah. And so friends, we can argue that the whole book of Psalm really brings it a climax where God's fulfillment of his promises, their hopes, is found in Messiah Jesus Christ. The second thing about the Psalms is the superscription, which is that those words you read before the psalm, most of them were put to the psalm a little later. I think probably when the five books were put together. Okay, but they were put there at a very early time, which means by the time of Jesus, because we still have extant copies of the Bible at the time of Jesus, right? The Old Testament Bible, the Hebrew Bible, the superscription were already there, which means that they are reliable for us to understand some background of the psalm. So today when we look at Psalm 92, it's important because out of the 150 psalms, there's only one psalm dedicated to Sabbath. How can that be, right? I mean, the Sabbath is important to the Jewish people, one of their key foundation of their rituals, but yet there's only one psalm that's dedicated to Sabbath. And in this psalm of Sabbath, we will see what they remember or what they praise God for on Sabbath. From the three motifs of covenant, which is God's love, creation, God's triumph, and finally, paradise, God's presence. So firstly, covenant, remembering God's love. When we look at Psalm 92, it's a chiistic structure, which means the first and last segment has similar themes. The second and second last has similar themes. And so the middle is the emphasis. Verse 8, God is exalted forever. The original context of this psalm is about a king who overcame his enemies. But for some reason, the person who put the psalms together, you know, attributed or rather used this psalm for Sabbath. And so the Jewish people will sing this psalm at the beginning of Sabbath and at the end of it. And the first thing they sing about is the covenant faithfulness of God. Yeah, the highlighted one is the superscription. It describes a song for the Sabbath day. And it begins, "It is good to give thanks to the Lord and to sing praises to His name." Now in Psalms, there are parallelism. The first statement is reinforced by the second. So give thanks, praise. Verse 2, "To declare His loving kindness in the morning and your faithfulness by night." By day, by night, the whole day, beginning with God's loving kindness and then His faithfulness. Loving kindness is the word hesed. It is the covenantal word for God. When God made His covenant with Israel, we talk about the hesed of God, the grace of God, the favor of God. And then it's with the 10-string lute and harp with resounding music upon the lyre. Which means they sang praises to God. They praised God for the covenant He made. They praised God for His love. Now friends, do we observe the Sabbath? Now certainly we do not need to observe the Sabbath by a Jewish person as required by the law. But it's important, an important pace of life, a rhythm of life in following Christ. Some of us find it hard because there's always something to do, right? We want to get ahead of the competition. There are agendas to be filled. There are tasks to be accomplished. And so it's hard to keep a whole day of Sabbath. And on Sabbath, we find it hard, but you know, yet that's what God wants His people to do. Why? See, when we observe Sabbath, it means that we recognize that God is sovereign. We recognize the lordship of God. And that is why we're willing to surrender what we want to do and accomplish and to take a day of rest. And coupled with a day of rest is not the Sabbath when we stop, but we spend time in solitude and silence. Now, solitude and silence doesn't mean you're passive and you don't do anything. Silence before God gives way to well-chosen words. A life of solitude, a solitude before God gives way to right choices and actions. I think a good example is Pastor Peter. He always used to remind me, you know, that we need to live this solitude and silence. And I'm always like, what? But you know, when you look at his life, I've been told by a few people, even just this week, more than one person have said to me, you know, they were encouraged by what he shared with them, even without him knowing. And I believe that is out of a fruitfulness of a life that's in pace with God. And so when we keep our Sabbath, okay, we keep a day of rest, it's not just physically resting. That's good. Or have recreation, which is important. Or even just worship. We need to worship God. But what about God do we remember? Psalm 92 tells us the Sabbath is about remembering who God is. It is like a pit stop where we realign our objectives, our priorities with God's. And importantly, it begins with the love of God. To remember that you are loved, to receive love. Otherwise, friends, our lives would be like a performance. You know, we'll be busy trying to perform. How am I doing at my work, as a father, in my church, before God? Because we'll try to fill that vacuum in our hearts by our performances, our achievements. And it's in vain. On the Sabbath, we stop. We stop to remember God's love for us, to receive His love. Gordon MacDonald is a well-known pastor. He led a church for many years. He was also once the chairman of World Vision, an author of many good books. And at one time, he was leading InterVarsity, which is a worldwide Christian student organization. Midway through his tenure, he suddenly resigned. You know, and later it was revealed that a few years before he had an affair and it came out. So everybody was shocked. This was a man of God used greatly by God. Years later, after he was restored to ministry, reconciled in his marriage, he began to go back into ministry to teach, to write, And you notice that his writing has shifted from the past. You know, the past is a lot about growth, a lot about following Christ. But in his later years, he talks about Sabbath. He says, in this particular book, he says that, you know, many times we're haunted by our past. We have missed concepts, even unconscious to ourselves that I'm unloved, that I'm not good enough. And so we go on this lifestyle of striving to be loved, to be good. And Sabbath is when we stop to receive God's love, to be healed of a brokenness. And so, friends, on a Sabbath, we take a day to worship God, to remember Him. Remember what? To remember God's covenant. That we are loved not because we are lovely, but because God has chosen to love us. Secondly, to remember His creation, God's triumph. For you, O Lord, have made me glad by what you have done. I will sing for joy at the works of your hands. How great are your works, O Lord! Your thoughts are very deep. A senseless man has no knowledge, nor does a stupid man understand this. That when the wicked sprouted up like grass, and all who did iniquity flourish, it was only that they might be destroyed forevermore. See, the enemies around us, those who does wicked, they seem to be blessed, to flourish, but it is only temporal. Ultimately, Lord, you are on high forever. God is exalted. This is the key of the whole psalm. God is to be worshipped because He's triumphant. And then from the climax, it comes down. It talks about enemies again. Behold your enemies, O Lord, for behold, your enemies will perish. All who do iniquity will be scattered. But you have exalted my horn like that of a wild ox. I have been anointed with fresh oil. My eye will look exultantly upon my foes. My ears hear of the evildoers who rise up against me. In this central passage that talks about God being exalted, it brings out the motif of creation. Now, our original context is, of course, this king who triumphs over his enemies. But think about it. The similar motifs happens in creation, where God triumphs over darkness, over chaos, to form order, to form light. You know where the concept of Sabbath came about, right? God imagined it. God didn't need Sabbath. He didn't need to rest, right? But He imagined it for us, His creation. And so it started in creation. They created. And it's interesting. You know, Eugene Peterson says this. He says, a day is described first as the conclusion of creative work of God. Then night, a time of sleep, the incursion of darkness, a threat to the order of creation, a sign of chaos to come. But it is morning that has the last word, and there was morning one day. Now, it's referring to a creation account. Every day after God described what happens, He would say, then there's evening, and then morning, and one day. Then there's evening, and then morning, and one day. Why? I mean, if you describe a day, it should be, then there's morning, and then God did everything, then there's evening, right? But then when we understand evening in the Hebrew mindset is termination, is chaos, darkness. Morning is penetration. It means that whatever we are facing, at the end of the day, light triumphs. Light penetrates the darkness. Order penetrates chaos. And that's what creation is about. That God is triumphant. And so on Sabbath, we remember the triumph of God. And as people of God, as children of God, we know that sin, death, Satan, sickness has been fought and defeated by King Jesus, by His death and resurrection. But the war is still ongoing because we are in the flesh and we are in the world. And so the Bible tells us we need to fight sin. We need to resist the devil. Sickness needs to be prayed over and groaned under. Death needs to be endured until Christ comes again. But He has triumphed over them. The decisive battle has been won. And that is why we can stand firm. That is why on Sabbath, we remember God has triumphed. In this COVID-19 era, we have struggles, yes. But, you know, there are times when we come before God to know that He has triumphed over darkness, chaos, and even viruses. And then, of course, there are other sicknesses. The sicknesses of busyness, right? One that's more insidious. You say, ah, yeah, how come we are 5 minutes late? You know, can you hurry up, please? And when such phrases start to creep into your vocabulary, you know, you have that bug called busyness. Too busy. If you come to my household, you often hear those phrases in the morning, and I'm the main source of it. Hurry up, hurry up, we are late. You know, and when we are busy, we live life in the fast lane. We go at breakneck speed. And you know what happens when you live life in the fast lane, right? Ultimately, you either run someone over or you get run over. We are not machines, friends. We need to stop. Sabbath is meant to remind us to stop. And when we don't stop, you know, God gives us yellow flashing lights, you know, before the big red light. It's time to stop. And many marriages today, or families, you know, are struggling. Not because, you know, the couples never loved each other, but maybe because we have been too preoccupied with secondary things that the passion has fizzled out. Children veer towards fringe behaviors, not because the parents didn't have good intentions, but because we were too busy to find healthy rhythms for our families. And so God will give us flashing yellow light, no, it's time to slow down. But do they catch our attention? I think COVID-19 is a flashing yellow light, or you may even consider a red light. To say maybe it's time to stop, to examine our souls, examine our families, our relationship, what truly matters. And our emphasis this year, we said family relationships. You know, we're all stuck at home and we realize that is primary to our lives. The bigger church family, the faith community relationships, to know one another, to be able to bear each other's burdens. And yet also the wider community, because we continue to live out what the church is called to do. Do you pay attention to the yellow lights of your life? You know, the Israelites, they were yanked out of Israel and captive to Babylon for 70 years. They were supposed to keep 1 year of Sabbath every 7 years. But for 490 years in the promised land, they did not do it. And God sent prophets, you know, yellow lights flashing, but they did not pay attention. And finally, he yanked them out of the promised land for every seventh year, 1 year of rest for 490 years, and that was 70 years. And so the land rested for 70 years. Do we need to wait till God gives us a red light before we know he gets our attention? I shared with you before, right? Last year, my health deteriorated, you know, throughout the whole year, and I realized it's got to do with the rhythm of my life. I mean, with COVID happening, you know, there a lot of things were thrown out of rhythm. You know, the stress, pressure, and then the work from home, everybody is around. By 12 o'clock, finally, the kids go to bed, right? And then you say, it's time to sleep. But, you know, you don't feel like sleeping. It's like, I want to do something at the time, right? So what do I do? Instead of reading the Bible, I turn on Netflix. And then before I know it, it's like, 3 a.m. But it's okay, you know, since it's work from home, I can make up for tomorrow. But you never make it up. And then over the months, you know, my health really deteriorated, right? I told you, I take blood tests every 3 months, so I know, you know. This year, things are better because I realized that I need to get the rhythms back. Physically, emotionally, spiritually, to have discipline. Because if I believe that God has triumphed, then all these issues that bothers me, you know, how do I deal with them? Not sleeping, you know, going on social media, they are my way of coping with stress, of coping with the changes. But once I realized that, then I turned my coping mechanism instead of to all these things, but to the Lord. And so on Sabbath, they are like pit stops for us to reconcile what we are doing, to receive God's love, to remember His triumph, and finally to remember His presence. The third motif in this psalm is paradise, verse 12 to 15, and it says, "The righteous man will flourish like a palm tree. He will grow like a cedar in Lebanon, planted in the house of the Lord, and they will flourish in the courts of our God." Now, this motif is similar to Psalm 1, right? Like a tree planted by the river. You know, when you're planted by a river, you naturally flourish because of what the river provides you. It's not because the tree was very intelligent. It was the gardener who put him there. It's God who allows him to grow. But notice, it's not planted in a garden, it's planted in the house of the Lord. In a temple, and then boop, in the middle there's a tree. That's the imagery. Why? What has this temple got to do with Sabbath? Why do they sing this song on Sabbath? Well, It's a lot. But the verse continues. It says, they will still yield fruit in old age. They shall be full of sap and very green. To declare the Lord is upright. He is my rock. There's no unrighteousness in him. To those who follow God, you'll be like this fruitful tree in the presence of God. The temple represents the presence of God. And it is the presence of God that we yield fruitfulness. In Exodus 25, when God gave the instruction for the temple, each of the verses begins with, and so God said to Moses, and then he gives some instruction about the temple. But the seventh instruction, okay, chapter 31, verse 12, it says, when God said to Moses about the Sabbath, and the Lord spoke to Moses, again, the same thing repeated. As for you, speak to the sons of Israel, you surely observe my Sabbath, for this is a sign between me and you throughout all generations. After giving the instructions for building of the temple, when it's completed, he talked about Sabbath. Sabbath is in the presence of God, rest. Just as the Garden of Eden, it was the presence of God, right? In the presence of God, after Eden was completed, God says, I enter my Sabbath. And it says, on the seventh day, thus heavens and earth were completed and all their hosts. By the seventh day, God completed his work which he has done. He rested on the seventh day from all his work which he has done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it. The word sanctified, like earlier in Exodus 31, God sanctified it. But notice this seventh day, what is different from seventh day from the first six? There's no, and there's evening, and there's morning, and there was one day. Every day there is, right? Evening, morning. But the seventh day, there's no evening, no morning. You see, the Sabbath is not a day. It is a period of time. It is not just a period of time. It is a person. What do I mean? God imagined and came up with this idea of Sabbath, one rest day and day of seven, to point forward to a time where we'll find rest in Him. And so, in creation, in Genesis, when God rested, it was not one day, it was extended. And later in Isaiah, when God talked to them also, he talks about the Sabbath day, when you do it as the time when in the millennium, when they have rest. And the Mishnah, which is the first written record of the Jewish oral tradition, he says that the Sabbath, this song, Psalms 92, is a song for a time that is to come. For the day that shall be all Sabbath and rest in the everlasting life. This is what the Mishnah says about Psalm 92. Sabbath is not just a day. It is a time, a period of time. It's not just a period of time. It is a person. The person of Messiah, the person of Jesus Christ. And that is what we see in the New Testament. Hebrews 4, it says, for we who have believed entered the rest. You see the idea of rest. Just as he has said, as I saw in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest, although his works were finished from the foundation of the world. Saying that God created the world and he entered rest. But to the Israelites, he wanted to bring them rest to the land of Canaan. But they were not willing. Since God rested on the seventh day of his work, and he told the Israelites, you shall not enter their rest, my rest, because they were disobedient. Therefore, since it remains for some to enter it, and those who formerly had good news preached to them failed to enter because of disobedience. So they were in the wilderness for 40 years. They failed. He again fixes a certain day, today, saying through David, after so long a time, just as has been said before, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. But if Joshua had given them rest, he would not have spoken of another day. See, to the Israelites, Sabbath was entering the promised land. But here the author of Hebrew is saying, if it is like that, then Joshua would have brought them in. But David, he quoted David in Psalm 95. He says, David, who was already in the promised land, is talking about another day to come. And so the author of Hebrews then argues that entering Sabbath is when we put our trust in Christ and obey Him. There remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For the one who has entered His rest has himself also rested from His works as God did from His. Jesus, the one who entered His rest, just like God. Therefore, let us be diligent to enter the rest so that no one will fall through the following the same example of disobedience. And that is why Jesus offered to all who are weary and heavy laden, come to me and I give you rest. So friends, when we want rest, our soul rest, it begins first by dealing with a problem of sin, to come to Jesus. Because when Jesus was on the cross, he demonstrated God's chesed. God's love, by His death, and by His resurrection, He demonstrated God's power and triumph over sin, darkness, death, and sickness. And because of what Jesus had done, we have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, the presence of God. So all three motifs that is sang about in Psalm 92, God's covenant, God's creation, God's presence, paradise, it deals with God's love, it deals with God's triumph, it deals with God's presence. We are all accessible through our Lord Jesus. And today, when we want to find rest, we first come to Christ because of what He has done for us. And this is a reminder that we are not God, and that is why we need Him. A constant reminder from God. That is why God gives us sleep. Why do you think God imagines sleep just as He imagines Sabbath? God doesn't need to sleep, right? Psalm 127, He says, "In vain for you to rise up early, to retire, to eat bread, for He gives sleep to His beloved." God gives sleep. Psalm 121, He says, "Behold, He who keeps Israel will neither sleep nor slumber." Who doesn't sleep? God. So why did He make us have to sleep? Like one third of our lives, right, we have to go into a death-like state for a few hours. And no matter who you are, the President of the United States or a regular person like me, we have to curl up like a helpless infant and then, why? John Piper says, you know, sleep is a parable that God is God and we are not. It's like a broken record that comes every 24 hours to say man is not sovereign, man is not sovereign, man is not sovereign. And since we are not sovereign, then why are we worrying about things that we need to do? Things that are beyond our control. And instead of trying to work harder to be in control, we learn to come before God to rest our control, to surrender. And I know it's not easy because, you know, I've shared before, I'm that kind, right? The going gets tough, the tough gets going. I would think that, you know, if I'm faced with a lot of work, I work harder. But, you know, as a result of that, you have other side effects in your health, your spirituality. Because when we keep going on and on, we allow ourselves to be vulnerable to sin, to sickness, to broken relationships. Because that was not how God designed us. In our sleep, in our rest, we acknowledge that God is God and we are not. And so let's look at Psalm 92 today. That's the question we have for ourselves, is how do we develop this rhythm of grace to walk in step with God? Sabbath, while it's hard to keep because we have so many things to do, is the foundation of a lifestyle of following Christ. And so some people ask me, you know, how's life? And I always say busy lah, busy, right? In Singapore, we always say very busy. And then one day, you know, I read this thing that Eugene Peterson wrote. He says, "But the word busy is the symptom not of commitment, but of betrayal." He's talking about a pastor, okay? "It is not devotion, but defection. The adjective busy set as a modifier to pastor should sound to our ears like adulterous to characterize a wife and embezzling to describe a banker." Oh, this is very serious. You know, after I read it, it's like, what? So next time people ask me, "Are you busy?" I say, "No lah." You know, and then he goes on to say, you know, he says, why do we want to be busy? Maybe two reasons. One, we want significance. Because you're busy means you're important, you know. I mean, you understand, right? You go to a hawker center pre-COVID days, which is the best store, the one with the longest queue lah. No queue, no good, don't go, right? So pastor is the same. You know, I show you my calendar. Oh, I'm very busy. It means I'm important. Either that or, you know, we're too lazy and cowardly to say no to people. And it's difficult. Everyone who needs help, I want to help, right? Because I'm a pastor. But then, you know, my schedule gets to fill up with everything else except God. Although we understand that we are doing God's work. And so for us, you know, how are we developing this rhythm of Sabbath in our lives? And so it came a point, you know, I determined that what kind of pastor or person do I want to be? I want to be a prayerful pastor. I want to be a pastor who cultivates his inner life. I mean, of course, you can say you want to have a big church and many, many worshippers, but really, in my heart of hearts, that's what I want. But it's not easy. You know, I first came to QBC. If you ask me how do I do my spiritual formation? I'll tell you exegesis, exposition, passing of verbs, grammatical sentences, Bible study, Bible memory, journaling, you know. It's great. And it got me results. I enjoyed my ministry. But, you know, it came a point I felt something was missing. When it was the States, you know, I started my ministry, the pastor had depression. So essentially, fresh out of seminary, they hired me, my wife, and they gave us a church, you know, because the pastor had depression. And so what do I know, right? So I did everything. It was good, you know, had fun. But I felt at one point I was like a headless chicken. I was just running everywhere doing all the good things. But what was the right thing? And so I burnt out. After a while, I was just like angry with people. It's like, man, you guys are not doing your work. Only I work hard, you know, because I'm Singaporean. Then I came back to QBC, you know, and then I met Pastor Peter, right? And then he tells solitude and silence. I was like, what? What's that? You know, but over the years, that's something I think has the greatest impact on my life. It is a journey, an ongoing journey for me. You know, even in this COVID season, I find it difficult and strange, right? We're home all the time, but it's difficult. But having this rhythm of grace, they are like pit stops to just stop and say, enough is enough, I stop. I'll take time for God. So it's not a responsibility nor a duty, but a joy, a blessing. We stop to rest. We stop to remember God's God, to remember His covenant, His creation, and His paradise, that we are loved, that God is triumphant, that He is with us, and He is God, and I am not. Let's pray. Father, I give thanks to You, even as we come and worship You today. Because of Your word, through Psalm 92, to remind us of what on Sabbath, you know, we are to do, to praise You for who You are, to remember You, to realign our priorities to Yours. And I want to give each of us some time just to be silent before the Lord, to respond in prayer. While we may not be used to this idea or we find it difficult, but we tell God that we want to pursue. There is an ongoing journey for us. An appropriate time, the worship team will lead us in response song.
Church, let us all stand.
Be still, my soul. The Lord is on thy side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leave to thy God to order and provide. In every change His faithfulness remains. Be still, my soul, Your best, Your heavenly friend, through thorny ways leads to a joyful end. Be still, my soul,
your God will undertake to guide the future as he has the past. Your hope, your confidence, let nothing shake. All our mysteries shall be clear and last. Be still, my soul, the waves and winds still know his voice who rule them while he dwells below. In you I rest, in you I found my hope, in you I trust, you'll never let me go. I place my life within your hands alone. Be still, my soul. Be still, my soul, the hour is hasting on, when we shall be forever with the Lord. When disappointment, grief and fear are gone, joys restored, our strivings all shall cease. Be still, my soul, when change and tears are past. All safe and blessed, we shall meet at last. In you I rest, I found my hope, in you I trust, you'll never let me go. I place my life within your hands alone. Be still, my soul. Be
Father God, we thank you for speaking to us on this Father's Day, revealing your heart to us, that as your child, we just need to be still and rest, and you will take care of us. How precious, Lord. Thank you for this day. Receive God's blessing. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling, and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now, and forevermore. Amen. Please be seated. Spend some time in meditation before you switch off your television. And we hope to see you again next week. God bless you. Keep healthy and keep safe.